intelligence. What we are using it today, hopefully for all the human good, and hopefully it will reduce some of the fears and anxiety about what artificial intelligence is about and what it could mean for the humankind. So I thought the best way to start would be to talk about how it's already changing lives of people who cannot see. Can this become their eyes, right? Can artificial intelligence allow blind people to see things that they cannot see and live a more normal life and have a more, have higher employment, frankly, for them, so that now they can actually do things in the corporate sector that they couldn't do today. So I thought I'll make it real by showing a video, and then we can go and talk about all of the applications that we are seeing today.
Natural language generation capability to describe the scene to the visually challenged person.
Smart glasses like this have a camera inbuilt, and then it becomes very interesting because it will talk via Bluetooth to the accessibility solution, and then all you have to do is wear this glass, and as you tap on your cell phone, you can see and hear more about the world around you.
It was very difficult for me to identify the glass doors which are there in this corporate buildings. And I used to bang on those glass doors. But now with the solution created by Accenture, helps me to identify those glass doors.
Analyzing the scene, there is a glass door in front of you.
And with the support of this solution, I can walk into the doors without hurting myself.
Drishti can also be used to identify new Indian currency notes, which is often confused with lower denomination notes by the blind.
After demonetization, it has become very difficult to identify the currency, but this solution supports me even to identify those new currencies, which is very, very, very helpful so that I cannot be cheated.
So that's what artificial intelligence can do today, right? It gives you a great perspective. So at Accenture, how do we see artificial intelligence? It's a series of technologies that come together, but the way we see it is it's about extending human capabilities. So there are things that humans can do today. Can we do those better? Can we do those in a more efficient and effective manner? And can we improve our lives, right? That becomes a fundamental. There's always a good side to a new technology. There's always a bad side to a new technology. Right? Imagine the time when cars were coming and horse carriages were going out. There was a good side to that and a bad side to that, and we started living with it. Then modernization of agriculture, right? So there's always something good in anything that's new that's coming out, that's why it's coming out. There's always something bad in it. The question is, how do you harness the good of it and leverage it for whatever purpose you have in mind, right? And that's the way we see here. And all the applications that we talk about are all about making humans, you know, having a better life. So we talked about empowering the blind. Now imagine developing economies, imagine large agricultural lands, imagine few people managing those, imagine the fact that they're pretty much at saturation right now, and the only way to get more out of those lands is by using the same land again and again and again, which means you have less opportunity to have an error in the way you're driving the growth, which means you have to look at the plantation all the time, figure out where the trees are not growing well, figure out where humans have to go and intervene to fix any issues with a certain crop that may be happening. That was the exact challenge that we were working on in one of the Asian economies. The way this got solved was you would have drones flying, but then who has the time to see all the data that's coming out of drones? I don't have time to see hours and hours, thousands of hours of footage to figure out where I will go and I will fix the next tree. So then you use deep learning, which you know you're talking about, in terms of the machines analyzing all the trees, looking and saying where there may be growth issues, where there may be weeds growing, and then telling the human beings that are on the ground and saying, sector 9 has this problem, you should solve it. Sector 11 has that problem, you should solve it. As a result, 20 people would be manning land that would otherwise require 200 people. That's another application. So think about the Fiji Island example, right? Think about any large plots of land. There may be risks with oil rigs. There are oil pipes going. I don't have people to go and man thousands of miles of oil pipes. And if I'm not manning them, I may be creating risk for the economy because of spillage, because of leakage, because of any other issue, right, that could impact the pipeline. How do I manage that large scale of pipeline without investing millions of dollars in it? By using drones, by using advanced technologies, by using machine learning and artificial intelligence to automatically tell me where the risk is, where the danger is. So that's where artificial intelligence is being used today, both on the government sector as well as in the corporate sector, which is about looking at risks of different type, right? Whether it's manning the airports today to identify objects that shouldn't be there, whether it's looking at the emotion, whether it's crowd counting from the safety standpoint, right? So there are governments that are actually, there are police departments that are applying this kind of technology to see, is there a crowd gathering somewhere where it shouldn't be gathering? Can I anticipate certain type of violence or certain type of incident before that happens so I can go and intervene much before it happens? Where should I be putting more cops on the ground, right? Traffic monitoring. Are there certain signals, certain intersections where I see a higher level of accidents just because of the way the signals are set up or the way people are having traffic patterns or those things? License plate recognition, right? Can I identify vehicles that should be on the road, right? That are in the wrong place? You know, who are they associated with? Can I detect certain types of road behavior? There are all sorts of things that are being used today that can be identified using artificial intelligence, right? And has a huge safety aspect to it in terms of having our life be safer life without having an army of people monitoring us all the time. So just wanted to highlight that aspect of it. By the way, this thing is true as much for citizen safety as it's true for industrial safety. So imagine your industrial environment where people are working in very high-risk areas, having $10 cameras installed, right? So these don't have to be $1,000 high-end cameras. $10 cameras installed with some sort of a deep learning technology in the back end can tell you when a certain system may be at risk, right? Or certain aspects of your pipeline or your systems may be corroding today, so you gotta go fix it. But you don't need an army of people walking around in those industrial environments to do that. Transforming society, so I can give you enough examples about what's happening with Singapore government, what Canadian government is doing, what UK government is doing, and then the answer would be like, yeah, those are our developed economies, they can afford to do it, right? But they are doing it, and the same technology can be brought to developing nations too. And I'll talk a little bit about why that is becoming easier now than I would say probably 10, 15, 20 years ago. But the idea of understanding traffic patterns, people movement, informing where government should be investing the resources, whether it's for a drug relapse program, right? So imagine you only have 20 people who are supporting a drug relapse program, and you have 1,000 people who are part of that program. You cannot give the same attention to the same 1,000 people, which means you have to prioritize who is at higher risk of relapse and who is at lower risk of relapse, so that you can give more time and attention to the ones that are at higher risk. Machine learning and artificial intelligence allows you to do that, so you can prioritize your scarce resources to support the economy in a bit more strategic, in a bit more targeted manner. right? No different than what marketers are doing today, whether it's Amazon or others, in figuring out, are you likely to buy something? Should I be marketing to you? Or should I be marketing to you? Take that and apply that in the government sense. You could do the same thing. Should I be giving you more resources or you, based on what your behavior is likely to be, right? Same algorithms taken from marketing, now apply for citizen life improvement, right? So there are many of these things you can borrow that are being built in the corporate sector that can be applied now into the public sector. The one thing I don't know whether we touched upon that is there's an idea of transfer learning in the models called deep learning, right? And the idea here is, if I train a certain deep learning model to figure out what movies I like to see, which is what Netflix uses, I take those algorithms and I bring them to a medical domain and apply them, what's the likelihood of certain ailments, I find that those algorithms are smart enough to be able to learn from one domain and apply to another domain. So all these algorithms that are available in the open source space, you can actually take something that someone else has developed. You don't have to go develop it all over again. You can take it, you can train it on a new data, and they are yours to use for your economy. So there are some advantages that these new smart algorithms are bringing that may make it easy for you to apply it to your own economy. Subservice, right? So we invest a lot of resources in telling our citizens what resources are available where. How do you want to file taxes, right? What kind of pension benefits will be offered to you? Where are these certain resources that the government provides, right? Here in the US, it's all about Social Security and all the services. We have armies of people that are manning these phones or responding to these citizens, right? Simply to tell them how to best use these resources. What if it was easier to communicate with the same citizens using artificial intelligence? So the same people who are manning the phones could actually be doing more emergency response services. So I could repurpose a lot of the work that I'm doing in governments and public service to focus on something that may be more critical, right? If I could take care of some of these basic aspects of public service management that I have to do manually today. So there are a lot of applications that we are seeing. This is an example of a European government. They had the same philosophy. They said, why would we want to have 100 people telling people about finance and taxes? I would rather the machines can do that, and if people have an issue, 10 people can handle that, and 90 people can actually go do something that's even more important to serve the same citizens. So it's not about taking away jobs. It's about finding even more important things for people to do that are doing certain basic tasks today, right? And that's where it's going. It depends on how you want to repurpose the people. What can they do? Can they upskill or not, right? Can they take on those roles and responsibilities or not? That's where a lot of the discussion is happening today. At Accenture, we are upskilling our own people to be able to do these things, because these things couldn't be done 10, 15 years ago. So there were no people that were skilled 20 years ago that were AI experts. Another example is in the health space, right? So if you think about it, at the core of who we are is the DNA, right? Our DNA tells a lot about what we will face or are facing in terms of ailments, in terms of development issues, right? Now, the belief that the medical world has is genome sequencing will make us more intelligent about what should I expect based on what my DNA sequence looks like. And the core philosophy is we all have a certain DNA sequence. Certain DNA sequences are more prone to cancer, certain sequences are more prone to strokes or certain other development. If I can identify what our sequence is and I can do analysis across billions of people, I can start to figure out what is the issue that I could be facing in the future, and I could then invest in appropriate resources to improve the life. The cost of DNA sequencing is very high, right? It's in thousands of dollars. Barely anybody can afford it except for the right people. Can I bring it to the masses in developing economy? That's the focus of a lot of artificial intelligence research. Can I reduce DNA sequencing down to $100, $10, and it becomes the same thing as a blood test or a cholesterol test that I do as part of my annual physical? I go in, I take a swab, my DNA is taken, they analyze my DNA, they say, okay, you gotta focus on these things, right? And make my life a lot easier. This technology, if available to the masses across developing economies, could change the way we really invest in our medical resources, the way we manage the health of our population. So there is a lot of potential in here. The value is in everyone coming together and solving. So just imagine for a second, right? Just imagine if AI could do these things. Auto-diagnose ailments and recommend treatments. Imagine you are in a developing economy, very few doctors, thousands of patients to see, right? You have minimal information. You don't have access to the latest research, right? That's probably being done in New York or somewhere else. Imagine if you had a system where you're putting in symptoms and it's telling you the top 10 diagnoses and top 5 diagnoses based on the latest research, and now that research is available to that doctor in that developing economy. Right? Imagine the power of that. Imagine the power of detecting epidemics earlier. Now, I don't have a good way to communicate among doctors among different regions, but if that data was being put together where I could say, hey, I'm already seeing these kind of cases much earlier on, in the first week, in the first year, in the third day, and I could start detecting epidemics and attacking them much earlier. Predicting risky events for our citizen abuse, for industrial weather, to minimize losses, right? Educating. So we talk about education as another issue. We say, well, if we don't have the right education, we won't be able to code it right, which means the developing economies won't be able to benefit from the artificial intelligence. But the reason we can't have a lot of good education is we don't have enough resources. We don't have enough teachers who can teach, right? We don't have enough French teachers sitting in Africa, probably. Can we change that? Can an AI system, a really, really low-cost AI system, be the teacher in that room where I can't afford 10 teachers, one for history, one for geography, one for math? Can an AI system do that and teach the basics, right, in a very, very low-cost manner and really democratize education? That's the kind of phenomena that's happening right now in many, many small countries, in fact, in India, where I'm closer to, right? The power of education to the masses in a very low-cost manner. Or optimizing state services through intelligent augmentation. Do we really, as a state, have to spend a lot of money to provide these services, or could I use for some other reasons and really use machines to optimize the state services that we are providing so that I can release my budget to do other programs for citizen welfare? So from my standpoint, the way I see it, the way we work with our clients, we see a lot of potential in how AI could actually improve citizen life. The question is one of, if we don't have the right infrastructure, if we don't have enough budget, if we don't have enough investment capacity, how are we going to do it, right? Now, where the world is going is the whole idea of cloud infrastructure. If you look at the cost of storage, and cost of compute, right? You just look at Amazon prices as an example. They have gone down 10x, 20x, depending on your reference point. So what used to cost a dollar earlier costs 3 cents right now in terms of just putting some data and just putting some computing capacity in the cloud. Makes it a lot more affordable, and we are seeing the impact of that in terms of the amount of computing that can be done today. So sometimes we feel like we may be overestimating what we really need in terms of investments to do that. The second phenomena that's worth talking about is open source. So if you're thinking you have to spend $100 million in licensing fees to license certain techniques or algorithms, that's no longer the case. These things are all free. You go to GitHub, these things are all free. As long as you know what you're doing with them, all the algorithms are available for free. All you have to do is use them the right way for training. If you look at TensorFlow, right? It's available to you. You don't have to pay $100 million of licensing to build AI systems on top of it. All you need is the right knowledgeable guys, two guys who can go build a nice system for you. The algorithms are available. Then the other piece that I find as part of Accenture is the global intelligence ecosystem. There are people that are contributing from across the globe, right? If you look at the work that's being done in India, how that is contributing to the advancements in North America. We see that in Accenture. We have a global team, and so are the freelancers that are contributing to this global intelligence ecosystem. I don't know how many of you guys know of sites like Kaggle, K-A-G-G-L-E.com. Right, now, this is the place where thousands of data scientists come in to contribute pretty much for nothing and develop amazing systems, amazing algorithms, because they pride themselves in being at the top of the leaderboard. Insurance companies, oil and gas companies, they're all going there and giving some of their toughest problems for $10,000. These people will work for $10,000 to get you the best algorithms from across the globe. That's the power of global intelligence ecosystem. And then the final piece is the augmenting human and machine intelligence. This is where I feel just having that right AI system with the right kind of people on the ground, right, which is where we are seeing most of the systems go, will make a huge impact. So these artificial intelligence systems don't have to $1 million systems. They can be really, really low cost. Some kids doing in their garage, that can be made available just with the right mindset to approach AI. At Accenture, we did research in terms of the impact of AI on different industries. And the impact will really come from the fact that you have people who are doing research, you have people who are doing activities. AI can help them do those activities better, right? And AI can help identify new sources of revenues for those services. So imagine personalized education, right? Imagine construction where I don't need to have an army of people just monitoring risks. Imagine financial services where I have less fraud to deal with, right? Now I can pass on the benefits to my clients, which means the prices go down, which means I can have much higher growth and financial services become more affordable. So there is always a positive side. I'm pretty sure there are a lot of negative sides too that all of you guys can outline for me. But if handled the right way, this is the research. It's available in the public domain. It's available on our website. I'm pretty sure there are 20 such research out there in terms of the positive impact of AI. I do want to, as someone who does this every day, I do want to touch upon what we see are success factors for AI, what is really required to make it happen. And whether it's private sector or government sector, you do need an alignment across the IT teams that really own the systems, the data science teams, the cool data scientists who are supposed to be building these algorithms, and the business or the people who own the P&L or the budget decisions. In terms of where we want to invest, what use cases are the most important for us, when will I see the value, who will be responsible for maintaining a system like this going forward? A lot of times we realize that the value doesn't come because the alignment is not there, because different teams are operating in different directions, and then when the systems get ready, it's not effective and it's not creating value, and we don't have any measurement system to really measure that value. This topic alone is a 3-hour topic on how do you really bring alignment across these is not easy, but I did want to put it out there. The second aspect is talent. Talent is absolutely important, right? There's no way you will be able to build this kind of system without the right kind of talent. And talent for this kind of capability is scarce. Right? But it doesn't mean we have to go and hire 30 data scientists. It could simply mean we leverage the freelance organizations that are out there. It means we could go to Kaggle and other places. And the workforce of future is truly moving towards a freelance environment where people want to work for themselves, people want to contribute when they want to contribute, and they want to enjoy their job. So there are different talent models that are coming up, and we publish research around that as well. Design thinking is very important. I feel this is one area where we underestimate. At the end of the day, these systems are being designed for human consumption. The last thing we want to do is focus so much on the algorithm and forget how a human will use the system, right? If I make it very difficult for a human to use the system is not going to work. I don't know how many of you use Alexa in some shape or form. All right, my kids use it for homework today. They will ask Alexa different spellings and other things. A few years ago, Alexa had a delay of 3 seconds. So from the time you ask a question to the time it gives you a response, it would be 3 seconds. It's not going to work. It's not practical. So the first thing they said is the response time has to go down, otherwise humans will not adopt. What is the right response time? Is it 1.5 seconds? Is it 1 second? Is it 0.5 seconds? Right? So that's the decision they had to make in terms of design thinking to bring Alexa to the market, right? So that people will adopt it, and then you know that's where you see a lot of adoption happening right now. Embed in the business or embed in the use case, having a system that's on the side that tells you something, right? Imagine you have the best knowledge about healthcare that's sitting in some dashboard somewhere, and there are doctors in the field that don't have access to that information. Because that intelligence is not embedded in the process, when I'm actually doing the treatment, it's a completely useless thing. But you'd be surprised by how many solutions get developed, where the output is really sitting somewhere else, and the frontline is not, does not have access to those capabilities. The question is, how do you make that available? Is it a mobile phone? Is it a dashboard? Is it an iPad? Is it something that's on paper that gets given to them? Embedding that is very, very important for the last one. So these are the four factors that we see as foundational for success of AI. I did want to address the topics that are on everyone's mind, and I know you address it too. Government is saying, what about job loss, right? Well, we have a major economic upheaval. Regulators are saying, is it compliant with the regulations? And business is saying, what if I put a virtual agent out there, right? Will it have a negative brand impact or a PR impact? Because I don't really control. There are a lot of open questions, right? Especially if you think about a company that decides to use an AI system, right? Someone, they use one of the providers, one of the cloud providers as the base for AI system. Someone goes and trains the AI system. The AI system makes a recommendation to someone. That someone eventually gets hurt because of the recommendation, because the recommendation was not perfect. Now the question becomes, who is really liable for that bad recommendation? Is it the cloud provider who provided the cloud capability? Is it the person who trained it? Maybe the data was not accurate, right? Is it the without the right disclaimers that, look, this is 90% accurate, but 10% of the cases it may not be perfect? Or is the use case that we picked that could put us in trouble? So where exactly, so there are a lot of these open questions that are out there. We have legal teams, Accenture legal teams, other legal teams working on these kind of problems. So I want to minimize the risk that is associated with this. But the way we think about it, the way we like to think about it is that if you have a movement called Responsible AI, which has the following elements, it has governance, right? So whether it's in the organizations, whether it's Facebook's, Google's, Amazon's all coming together, it has transparency in how the systems are being trained, what data is being used to train the system, and the fairness. It has reskilling as part of the movement. So as we are taking away lower-end basic tasks, are we upskilling people to handle more complicated tasks that are now becoming available? And the security. My data is out there. Everything about me is out there, right? Security, privacy. Can I handle that? Can I make sure that my private information remains private, right? Then in those things, if I can take care of those things, then I can establish the trust for people to start benefiting from AI system. So those are tough questions, but they have to be addressed if we really want to move forward. And to conclude, I mean, we don't have all the answers, but we definitely have good questions that are worth thinking about and enough impact in the marketplace for us to consider AI as mainstream right now. So thank you so much. Open to questions.
Thank you so much, Sharad. We'll go around for some questions. Maybe to start, just on the